This is Rummy's Corner. Is Canelo Alvarez the greatest super middleweight of all time? Cutting right to the chase, the short answer for me is no. Obviously not. However, in becoming the first undisputed world champion during the brief history of the relatively newer 168-pound weight class, Canelo may well have positioned himself to become a legitimate player in this discussion. The three names I see mentioned most frequently when discussing the greatest super middleweights of all time are Joe Calzaghe, Andre Ward, and Roy Jones Jr. Jones won the IBF super middleweight belt in November 1994 when he beat the undefeated pound-for-pound elite James Toney by 12-round unanimous decision. Jones defended that title five times, the last of which happened in October 1996 when he stopped Bryant Brannan in round two. But his marquee victory at 168 was undoubtedly against lights-out Toney. So in terms of championship fights at 168, Jones was a perfect 6-0 spanning just under 2 years. In that sense, regarding Roy's reputation at super middle, those who rate Jones as the 168 GOAT tend to do so based on hypothetical head-to-head criteria. Calzaghe won the vacant WBO super middleweight belt in October 1997 when he defeated Chris Eubank by 12-round unanimous decision. Calzaghe made many defenses of his title, but at that time, the WBO was like a dweller on the threshold. It was not considered a major world title at the beginning of his reign, but it was viewed as such by the end of his reign. Calzaghe later unified the IBF belt when he won a lopsided unanimous decision against Jeff Lacy. He later vacated the IBF belt. And in his last fight at 168, Calzaghe won the WBA-WBC belts when he defeated Mikkel Kessler by 12-round unanimous decision, and that was in November 2007, and that was Calzaghe's signature victory at 168. So in terms of championship bouts at 168, if we include Calzaghe's entire reign as WBO titleist, he had 21 consecutive title defenses. So he was 22-0 spanning just over 10 years. Unlike Roy's 168-pound reputation, Calzaghe's is based on longevity and consistency. Andre Ward won the WBA Super Duper belt in November 2009 when he won a technical decision against Kessler in round one of the Super 6 World Boxing Classic. Ward went on to win this captivating tournament in the final match against Carl Froch. Ward defeated Froch by 12-round unanimous decision, which earned Andre the WBC belt. Ward's last defense at 168 was a 10th-round victory against Chad Dawson in September 2012. Ward was slated to have another defense against Edwin Rodriguez the following year, but Edwin failed to make weight, so there was no title at stake. So in terms of championship bouts at 168, Ward was a perfect 6-0 spanning just under 3 years. Ward did not have the longevity of Calzaghe, nor did he have a signature victory matching Roy's big win against Toney. But Ward arguably had more quality wins at 168 than either of them, and can perhaps be seen as the most talented of the three. Enter Canelo Alvarez. If we exclude Canelo's win against Rocky Fielding for the minor WBA regular belt, Canelo first won a major title at 168 in December of last year when he defeated Callum Smith by a lopsided unanimous decision. Canelo won the WBA Super Duper belt and also the vacant WBC with the win against the undefeated Smith. A few months back in May, Canelo added the WBO belt when he won against the undefeated Billy Joe Saunders. And then just last Saturday, Canelo made super middleweight history when he stopped the undefeated Caleb Plant in round 11. So in terms of championship bouts at 168, Canelo is a perfect 4-0 spanning less than 11 months. 11 months! That's all the time it took for Canelo to win all four major titles of today, and he defeated three talented, undefeated champions to accomplish this. Let me repeat how long it took. Less than 11 months. That's incredible in this day and age. The mere fact that he fought four times in that span is commendable. Canelo set out to become the undisputed champion at 168, and he accomplished that goal in less than 11 months. It really is extraordinary. Not the four belt stuff so much, as a lot of that is politics. With the shady behavior of all the alphabet bodies, politics often prevents boxers from even getting a chance for four titles at once. Look no further than the heavyweight division. It's been 22 damn years since we have had an undisputed heavyweight world champion. 22 damn years. So Canelo joins guys like Bernard Hopkins, Jermaine Taylor, Terence Crawford, Alexander Usyk, and Josh Taylor. But the other thing that is commendable for Canelo is that unlike the previous undisputed champions in the four belt era, Canelo is a bona fide superstar in boxing. Obtaining the star power that Canelo has acquired makes doing these things, or avoiding these things, well, star power certainly makes things a little easier. Think of the two biggest superstars from the last generation, Floyd Mayweather Jr. and Manny Pac-Man Pacquiao. Despite all of their incredible star power, and despite all of their respective vast achievements in professional boxing, neither Mayweather nor Pacquiao ever became a four-belt champion in any of the many weight classes they competed in. Sure, politics plays a role, but when you have the star power of a Floyd or a Manny, if they ever wanted to become undisputed in any division, they at least had the financial pull to open the right doors for such an opportunity. But Floyd and Manny never endeavored to become undisputed. Canelo did, and he used his star power to make it happen. So circling back to the greatest super middleweight of all time, Joe Calzaghe, Andre Ward, Roy Jones Jr. And for the record, there have been other great super middleweight champions who might be worth mentioning in this discussion, like Mikkel Kessler, James Toney, Nigel Benn, Chris Eubank, Steve Collins, Sven Otke, and Chongpao Park, and of course, Carl the Cobra Frotch. He beat George Groves in front of 80,000 fans at Wembley Stadium. But regarding the big three in the brief history of the super middleweight division, I don't think you can say that Canelo belongs in that same category just yet. That mighty trio represents the best of the best at 168. Now that is not to say, however, that guys from the past like the Cincinnati Cobra, Ezzard Charles, or Archie Moore, the Old Mongoose, guys like the Cincinnati Cobra and the Old Mongoose usually aren't even considered when we talk about the greatest in history at 168. But if they had 168 back then, and guys like Ezzard and Archie competed in that weight class, or if we had hypothetical time machine matchups, where we grab a 168-pound Old Mongoose into the DeLorean and put him in there against a Joe Calzaghe, or an Andre Ward, or a Roy Jones Jr., or hell, even a Canelo Alvarez. I don't know. I'm not saying they all lose against the Cincinnati Cobra or the Old Mongoose. But if those guys were situated into this discussion, then the discussion changes drastically. But in the context of looking back no further than 1984, Canelo hasn't reached that elite trio yet, but in a very short time, in less than 11 months, Canelo has already done something that none of those guys did in their careers. Canelo is the reigning, undisputed, lineal WBA, WBC, WBO, IBF super middleweight world champion, and he is the only boxer in history who can say that. And even though Canelo is not as accomplished as that trio at 168, you can already make a reasonably strong case that, with the exception of Roy, Canelo has already achieved more in his career as a whole. So if Canelo decides to stick at 168 for a while longer, and if he remains as active as he's been and keeps winning, then he might well transform this elite-level all-time trio at 168 into an elite-level all-time quartet. In other words, even in his brief stint at 168, Canelo has already made a lot of noise, and he certainly set himself down the right path to perhaps someday be mentioned alongside those three when it comes to the discussion of the greatest super middleweights in history. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you enjoyed, and have a wonderful night. This is Rummy's Corner.